Hi and welcome to part two of the How to Create an After Effects Plugin series. And if you watched part one, you saw that we created this straight line here, and the straight line looked really dodgy. You couldn't change the thickness. It had no anti-aliasing. The only thing you could do is change the start, end, and the color. So we're going to improve on this using a different technique. The previous version was done almost like a shader, where we had an algorithm, a very simple algorithm, that determined whether we should draw the pixel or not, whether it was part of the line or not. And this worked okay for drawing a very basic line, but that's not, A, it's not efficient, and B, it's very difficult if you want to expand upon it. My first idea for a plugin was a plugin that drew a curved line, a sexy curved line, and I thought I don't know how to do that, so let's just start with a straight line. And then I hired a Russian programmer to build that for me, and he did. And this was the code that he came up with, and it was very similar to, it was using the same method that we used in part one, except this one has more features. This actually has all the features of the default After Effects plugin CC Beam, I think it is. So you can do softness, an inner color, an outer color, a thickness. But as you can see, it's quite a lot of code. And then when I asked him, okay, this looks great, now we need to make it curved, he ran away, because I don't think that adapting this code to draw a curved line is a trivial task. So we're not going to be doing this method. We're going to be using a 2D graphics library called Cairo. That's going to make it way more efficient, way easier on us, just better all round. Drawing shapes based on algorithms run on every pixel of the buffer is more of a GPU thing. The GPU is quite efficient at that because it has hundreds or thousands of cores to do so, but the CPU is not very good at that. And although you can multiprocess it a bit, it's still an inefficient way to go. So that's why we're going to be using a library. To get started, you can go to chirographics.org, and there's a download page here. The header files you can just download. However, for the library, you'll need to build the library, and there's instructions here. It's different for Windows and Mac, so I won't be showing that. But essentially, when you're finished that, you'll end up with two libraries on Windows, and potentially I think it's three on Mac. There's a Cairo library and a pixel manipulation library, and I think on Mac there's a libpng library that's required, but I'm not 100% certain. So once you've got them, just put them wherever your project file is. Same as the previous lesson, we're just working with the skeleton sample provided in the SDK. So again, if you're not familiar with that, check out episode 1. And then we've also got an include folder here which has the Cairo headers that you can download. Now inside Visual Studio, let's come to the C++ additional include directories. And because the path that we had was relative, I'm just going to go dot dot slash, and then it was inside a folder called include. So the dot dot slash is relative to where the project file is. So we wanted to go back one and then enter the folder called include. So now we should be able to access those headers. And then we want to do the same thing for the library. So that's under linker. Under general, we can go to additional library directories, and we want dot dot slash lib. And then for the actual libraries themselves, let's come in here and we want cairo.lib and pixman.lib. Then we hit apply, okay. And now we should be able to include the header. So I'll come into the header file, and here are the default includes. This is just my include. That's not necessary for this tutorial, but that's just in my template. So we go hash include cairo.h, and that's picking it up, which is a good sign. We can then open that to see, yes, we have Cairo included. Now if we go back to skeleton, the render function here currently doesn't do anything. It's just we clear the output buffer by filling it with black, which is good, because otherwise there'll be junk memory in there. So to get started, what we can do is we can create a Cairo context. The first thing we need to do to get started is we need a Cairo surface. So we create a variable called Cairo surface t, and this is going to be a pointer, and I'll just call this surface, and then we can equals Cairo image surface create. So Cairo image surface create, and now we can insert the arguments. So we need a format for this. I'm going to specify Cairo format, ARGB32. So what does that mean? Let's go to the definition here and we can see the different formats that we can have. This is a little bit confusing if you're working in After Effects because this is not 32 bits per channel, this is 32 bits for all four channels, which means 8 bits per channel. So just remember that. And then we need a width and a height, and I want this to be the output buffer size. So I'm going to go output width, then output height. Now we have a Cairo surface to draw to. If you're familiar with other APIs such as OpenGL, you'll be familiar with contexts. A context is essentially an instance, and each instance or context can have individual settings changed. So this tutorial is going to be very simple, and we're only going to be using one context, but more advanced things will require multiple contexts. To do so, we just create Cairo_T, and this is, again, is going to be a pointer, and the naming convention for a Cairo context is just CR, and then we can go equals Cairo create and pass it in that surface that we just created. So it's now looking for a pointer to a surface. Now that we've got that, we can actually draw something with Cairo. So there's a really great page called Cairo Samples, and there it tells you how to draw many different things. I want to draw a circle just for demonstration purposes, just so that we can see something's being drawn. If we peek this definition here, we can see the arguments are as follows. We need to point it to a context because it needs to know which context are we drawing this arc in. Now we need to provide it the center of this arc. And I want this circle to be drawn in the very middle of the screen, so I'm going to tell it I want it to be the output width, but times it by 0.5. And because the output width is an integer, I'm just going to cast that to a double so that we can work with if the buffer happens to be an odd number, that's going to still be exactly in the middle. And then I want it also to be the output height times 0.5, and that's going to draw it exactly in the middle. Now we need to specify how big does the circle need to be, or the arc. And I have some debug slider parameters here, so I'm just going to pass in left. And that will allow me to control the size of the circle. The next argument is the angle start and then the angle end. So if you pass 0 for the start and 2 times pi, then it's going to draw a complete circle. However, it doesn't know what m_pi is because I haven't included the math library, so I'm just going to include plugin filter pi, which if you go to that definition is defined in the AE effect callback.h. Now, it doesn't know about the left parameter, so I'm just going to put that up here so that it knows. This way of specifying angles doesn't really make sense for drawing circles. It's more intuitive if you're drawing arcs, such as here, so you specify a start and end arc, but it can also be used to draw a full circle. Now, once we've got that arc, we need to tell Cairo that we actually want to draw it because it hasn't drawn it. So we go Cairo fill, and then we just pass a context. So you don't have to do a fill, you could go Cairo stroke, such as they've done here, but we want a solid circle. Now, what color is it going to be drawn as? Well, we need to tell Cairo that as well. To do that, we type in Cairo set source RGBA, and it needs a context and then the RGBA color, starting with red. I'm just going to make this white so that, just for simplicity's sake, and 100% opacity. Another confusing difference between After Effects and the Cairo library is that although this is an 8-bit buffer, it's still going to take the color values as floating point, as opposed to After Effects, where if it has an 8-bit buffer, it's going to be wanting these between 0 and 255. But however, I think the Cairo method is more intuitive, and I just much prefer working with floating point color values than the 8-bit characters that After Effects uses. Let's just take a look at what we've done. We've created a surface, and that surface has been used in to create our context. We've set a color for the context, we've specified a shape, and then we've told it to actually draw that shape. However, it's drawn it in a Cairo buffer, it hasn't drawn it in our After Effects buffer, so we need a way to blit that buffer from Cairo to After Effects. The way we're going to do that is we'll need a pointer to the Cairo world, a pointer to the After Effects world, and then we can simply transfer the values or the data across. To do that, I've got a custom data type called a Cairo refcon, and it's very simple. It's a very simple struct. It contains a pointer to an After Effects world, being a PF effect world, a pointer to the Cairo data, and then a stride. If we come back to the render function, we can point this character pointer to the Cairo data by typing in Cairo image surface get data, and then we pass it the surface that we want. And we also need to know the stride, which is the distance in memory between the pixels. And then to set the After Effects pointer, I'm going to set this as the output because I want to send the Cairo world straight to the output buffer. However, this is taking just a PF effect world, not a pointer, so I'll dereference that. Now we can pass this custom Cairo refcon to a function that's this function here, Cairo copy 8, which is going to copy our data from the character pointer to the output buffer. So the way we do this is with an After Effects function, and this function is very interesting. It allows us to essentially multi-thread any problem that can be broken up into smaller pieces. It's going to do that, and the way it does that is either row by row or column by column. We're going to do that in row by row. So we're going to tell this function that we want to run this on every row of the output buffer. So output height, that's how many times this function is going to run. So on a 1920 by 1080 composition, this function is going to run 1080 times. We pass it the data that we want to send to each instance of this, and then we tell it which function we want to execute. Now let's go through what this function actually does. Here we have the refcon that we passed to this function. So we've set that up there. And then using this integer I, we know which iteration we're currently on, because if we want to break the problem up into smaller pieces, we need to know which piece of the puzzle this is. So we know by I which row we're currently on. This here is a pointer to the output. This is our world pointer, and essentially this takes in a world and an x and y coordinate, and it's going to pass us back the pointer. We actually used this sample integral 8 function in the first lesson. So I'm saying I want a pointer to the output data, which is the effect world that we specified here. The x position is 0, and the y position is the iteration that we're currently on. This here does essentially the same thing, but it accesses the data from the Cairo context, and to do so, it uses the stride. So that's why we had to know how big the stride was. Then once we have pointers to the After Effects buffer and the Cairo buffer, pixel by pixel, we want to actually get that data. And so then we have a for loop, which for every pixel, for every column rather in the buffer, it's going to do something. So this function here is run on every row, and then this for loop here is run on every column. And that means that every pixel in the buffer will be processed. And because it's broken down per row, that can be split across multiple CPUs, and essentially it becomes multi-threaded. Now let's fill in here what should happen per pixel. So world pointer, and we'll start with the alpha channel because that's the most important. That's going to equal row P, and we want, this is just a large 1D array, and we want to specify X, so output width, and then we need to bit shift that 24 places, because if we just accessed the value at row PX, that's actually going to be where the blue channel is. That's just how the information is laid out in Cairo. So we take that, then we bit shift it across to the right 24 places, and that is for to skip those three channels, to skip the red, green, and blue channel, and that's going to end us up at the alpha channel. Now what we want to say is if world pointers alpha is greater than 1, then let's do something. So only if we have an alpha value should we worry about the color channels. Now this may not suit every situation, but this is going to suit our situation, and it's going to be more efficient because we're just saving on processing time. Then if we have an alpha channel, then let's go world pointer red equals row P X shifted across 16 places, so one less than the alpha channel, and that's that. Then let's do the same for the green and the blue. Let's shift 8 and 0, and this one's going to be green, and this one's going to be blue. Okay, so there we have it. Now what we need to do is, for every pixel, we need to increment the world pointer. Otherwise, the world pointer is always going to be sitting on the first pixel. We don't need to do this for the row pointer because it's an array. We access it at X, and X already gets incremented per column. So that's why we only need to do it for the pixel pointer, the After Effects pixel pointer. Let's give this a whirl and see what's going on. Now, I've just got some errors here, and I think I remember the reason that I'm getting these errors is because I'm using a static library of Cairo, and that's just so that I can distribute my plugins. And if we want to do that, we need to set a definition, and I have it here. We need to set this, and this is only for Windows. So this, you could set an ifdef for the operating system, such as up here, if After Effects, if we're on Windows, then define Cairo Win32 static build, but I'm not gonna worry about that. So hopefully now we can actually build the project. Now, I think we have a problem here. If we add another red solid underneath it, we'll see that we're getting this sort of fringing happening. And the reason that that's happening is if we just solo on our skeleton layer and go to the red channel, we can see that the red channel is already pre-multiplied. So what happens when we then, or when After Effects then takes that and then multiplies it by its alpha channel, that produces this dark fringe here. And we do not want a dark fringe around our shapes. So what we need to do to avoid this problem is divide the color channel by the alpha channel. And that way, when After Effects then multiplies the color channel by the alpha channel, we won't then receive this fringe. So that will essentially undo the issue. To do that, what we do is essentially just divide this by the alpha channel. Now, if this was, say, a value of 255 or white, and we divided that by 255 or white, that would end up at a value of 1, and we don't want a value of 1. We want our value of 1 to be a value of 255. So let's just put that in brackets and then multiply that by pfmaxchan8. Let's just suppose that this red is white. It is 255 divided by 255, which is a value of 1, and then that gets multiplied by 255, which would then give us an 8-bit value of white. So we can just copy this for the other channels and shift that 8, shift that 0. Okay, that is not correct. We're getting a black result. Let's see what went wrong. Okay, and the reason that that didn't work is because this value that we took from the row pointer was not being interpreted as a character. So that needs to be cast to a character. Then this value here will be divided by the alpha. And then that's eventually, if it was white, it would be a value of 1. And then that is multiplied by 255 to equal 255. So sorry about that confusion. Casting these 8 and 16 bit values is a bit tricky, but there we go. We got there in the end. And the reason we drew a circle was just so that we could confirm that our Cairo drawing and then blitzing from the Cairo buffer to our output buffer actually worked. And it is. So the next thing we're going to do is, instead of just drawing the circle, we're going to add the parameters to draw our line. And we're going to be able to choose our own custom color and then maybe a thickness and an opacity. And this video is already pretty long, so we'll do that in the next lesson. And that, I promise you, will be out in 1 week's time. So stay tuned and thanks for watching. This episode was sponsored by Plugin Everything. That's right, we sponsored ourselves. So you probably already know what we do. We create plugins for After Effects, but if you didn't, well, now you know. So please buy our plugins so that we can continue to make more good plugins and some bad ones as well as more tutorials on how to make plugins.